Class 9 Biology, Chapter 3, Diversity in Living Organisms, Video Number 1. Topics covered: Biodiversity, Classification and its Importance, Characteristics used for Hierarchical Classification, Classification and Evolution, Systems of Classification and Taxonomic Categories. When you see all around yourself, you find a variety of life forms that vary in their shape, size, color, habit, habitat, etc. Okay, so have a look at this picture. This picture shows so many different kinds of organisms, and all these different kinds of organisms, they vary in many of the ways that I have just now mentioned. So this existence of variety of life forms that vary in their external appearance, shape, size, color, lifespan, habit, habitat, etc. is what is called as biodiversity. Here are some examples to show how, in what way the life forms existing on Earth vary. So the variations can be seen in terms of size. On one hand, you have got organisms like bacteria, which measures just few micrometer. 1 micrometer is just 10 to the power of minus 3 of a millimeter. So small it is. On the other side, you have got organisms or animals like blue whale measuring around 30 meters, or the redwood trees in California, which measures around 100 meters. In terms of lifespan, you have organisms like the mosquitoes, which live for just few days, and there are organisms or plants like the pine tree, which lives for thousands and thousands of years. This variation is also seen in terms of the color. You have got organisms like the worms and the jellyfishes, which are colorless, right? And the other side, you also have butterflies, birds, and many flowers which are beautifully colored. So these variations you not only find in terms of shape, size, and color, shape, size, lifespan, and color, but the variations are also seen in terms of the places where they live, the kind of food that they eat, in many of the ways. And if we talk about the total number of species which are existing on Earth, it is somewhere at present, like if we discuss, it's somewhere around 8 million or around 8.7 million or so. But of the total number of species that is estimated to be existing on Earth, till now scientists have been successful in studying only 1.7 million of species, or 1.3 million of species. That means that many of the species have not been identified and studied yet. And think about, if you have to study the features of each and every species that is existing on Earth, a glance of each and every species, just a look at the pictures of each and every species that is existing on Earth, where you have to spend a fraction of a second, that is going to take a lot of time, maybe days or years together. So to study in detail every species that is existing on Earth, this will become next to impossible. So to make our study easy and systematic, what we do is, what scientists have suggested is, why not sort these organisms into groups and subgroups on the basis of their characteristic features. This sorting of organisms into groups and subgroups on the basis of similarities and dissimilarities is what is called as classification. Okay, so organisms, like if when you are studying organisms, you will may find that some of the features that they have are in common. So if you find features in common are more, the organisms will be placed in one group. And if you find fundamental differences amongst the organisms, they are separated into different groups. So this sorting of organisms into groups and subgroups on the basis of similarities and dissimilarities, and then placing them in a hierarchy, the largest group and then coming to the smallest group, that is what is called as classification. Now, before we discuss about the systems of classification, we need to know, why is classification important? So classification, it is important because it makes a study of wide variety of organisms easy and systematic. It provides before us a picture of all the life forms that is existing at a glance. So it projects before us a picture of all the life forms at a glance. Then it helps us to understand the relationship among the different groups of organisms that are existing. Then it also provides us a system for identification of known and unknown species of organism. If you find something or you have never seen that particular creature, and if you want to know whether it is an insect or whether it is some other creature, with a proper system of classification, a knowledge of a proper system of classification, you'll be able to identify it quite easily and then place it in a particular group. Right? Then a study of one or two members of a group will give you information about the entire group. Like if you are studying about mammals, it's not that each and every species of animal that comes under mammal has to be studied. Just one or two examples, take an example of human being, or you take example of a cat or a dog, and some features when you study, you get a those will be the features of others also, others which are included in the class of mammals. Like all mammals have got mammary glands, that is they feed their young ones with their own milk. Other is that they have a body covered with hair. So by studying one or two members of a group, one gets a rough idea about all the members existing in that particular group. And there are many branches of biology, like you've got medicine, forestry, ecology. All these branches depends upon a proper system of classification for studying organisms. So this is the importance of classification, and this is why we need a proper system of classification. And many scientists, many biologists have tried to classify the living world in different ways. So one of the earliest system of classification was given by Aristotle. What he did was that he classified the animals on the basis of their habitat. This was one of the earlier system of classification which was not at all accepted for a longer period of time, because it's not that any characteristic has to be taken and then you classify it. We have to decide which characteristic form gives the fundamental difference between the groups that are to be sorted, and that which gives a basic difference that will be used first to make the broadest group, and then you come up with the next characteristic feature which is of less importance than the previous one but is dependent upon the previous one. So Aristotle, what he did was he classified the animals on the basis of habitat. And when he did, problem was found that dolphins, shark, whales, seals, stingray, octopus and squids, starfishes, all were placed in one group. And now you might be quite aware of that these different organisms, they belong to different groups. Whale and dolphins are mammals. A shark is a fish, right? Seals are also mammals. So seahorses and sharks are fishes, right? Squids, they are totally different from fishes. So this system of classification was not accepted for long, because the characteristic that was taken into account was not an important characteristic. Why? So classification, it is done on the basis of characteristic, but not just any characteristic has to be taken. That particular characteristic which shows a fundamental difference between the different groups, that has to be considered to make the broadest group, and then you have to go on sorting organisms into smaller and smaller groups on the basis of those characteristics or features which are of less importance but then dependent upon the previous group. So this is how classification is done on the basis of characteristics. Now what are characteristics? Characteristics are the details of forms and functions. Details of forms and functions or the details of appearance and behavior of an organism. For example, you take, this is a bird. So the characteristics of a bird will be that it has got a streamlined body, it has got one pair of wing. So these becomes a character. They have got hollow bones. So these are the characteristics or features which are detailing their appearance, how they look, and behavior, how do they work. So the details of forms and functions of an organism is what is called as characteristics. Okay, so that's on the basis of these characteristic features, classification is done. Now, as I said, you characteristics are to be fundamental features which shows the basic difference between the two groups. So let us now study about what are those characteristic features that are used for hierarchical classification. So let's study about that. The first and the most basic feature that is used for classification is the cell design. You all have studied and you are quite aware of that there are two types of cell designs. One is a prokaryotic cell design, other is a eukaryotic cell design. And these two types of cell designs are quite different. In case of a eukaryotic organism, which has got eukaryotic cells, you find that the cells have got a well-defined nucleus and there are membrane-bound organelles like mitochondria, endoplasmic reticulum, all these things have been told to you. So because of this well-organized structure, you find that the eukaryotic cells, they work quite efficiently, and the biochemical reactions that go within the cell, the different types of biochemical reactions that go, and these biochemical reactions are required for maintaining their structure and function. So these reactions that go, they go without interference. What is happening in the mitochondria will not be interfered by what is happening in the Golgi complex or the endoplasmic reticulum. So this is what you find, because of this, you find that the eukaryotic cells, they are much efficient when compared to that of prokaryotic cell. In case of prokaryotic cell, you find that the nuclear region is not well defined. You've got just a nucleoid, which is just which lies naked in the cytoplasm. And also you find that the membrane bound organelles, these are all absent. So definitely the biochemical reactions that are taken by a prokaryotic cell is going to be different from that of eukaryotic. And hence the cell design of a prokaryote is different from that of a eukaryote. And so the organisms which are prokaryotes cannot be placed with eukaryotes. So the first important feature which gives the broadest difference between the different types of living organisms is the cell design, that is whether the organism is prokaryotic or eukaryotic. Also, because of the presence of a nucleus, eukaryotic cells can make multicellular body. They may be either unicellular or multicellular. They are capable of making multicellular body, but prokaryotes cannot make a multicellular body. They may be found in colonies, many cells together, but each cell will be working as an individual. So prokaryotes will be always unicellular, whereas eukaryotes can either be unicellular or multicellular. Because of nucleus, cells can organize to form multicellular body. So the first feature is cell design, and the next feature that is used for the classification, that is used for making the next broader group, is sorting is the body design. The organisms can either be unicellular or multicellular. Just now I said you, the prokaryotes cannot make multicellular body, but eukaryotes can be either unicellular or multicellular. In case of unicellular organism like paramecium and amoeba, these are eukaryotic unicellular organism, all the life activities are performed by the same single cell, right? But in case of multicellular organism, like you have got fungi, you've got animals, you've got plants. So here you find that in multicellular organisms, cells of similar type organize to form tissues, and tissues further organize to form organs, right? So here you find that there is a sort of division of labor. And so the body design of a multicellular will be different from that of a unicellular. So this becomes the next important feature for classification. Then the next important feature for sorting organisms into groups is the mode of nutrition. Organisms can either be autotrophic, that is they can make their own food from simple inorganic substances using light energy or chemical energy, or the organisms can be a heterotrophic, that is those which obtain ready-made organic matter from outside sources. So next, as a mode of nutrition is different, the body designs of the organism will be different, and so this becomes the third important feature for classification. The plants cannot be placed with animals in one group because plants have got a different mode of nutrition from that of the animals, right? Now, so this is the next important feature. Then you have got the plants. Plants again are further classified. And this classification of plants is based upon certain features which you'll be learning in detail in my later videos, right? So here in case of plants, you find that the features that are used is the level of organization, then the ability to make seeds, right? The presence or absence of vascular tissues. These are some of the features that are used for dividing plants into different groups, right? On the other hand, animals, they'll be classified on the basis of the way the body of the animal has developed and the kind of specialized organs that are found for different functions. Remember one thing, that the characteristics that are used for classifying plants will be different from that of animals. It cannot be the same characteristic. For classifying plants, you can use a characteristics like the presence or absence of vascular tissue, that is xylem and phloem. The characteristics like ability to bear seeds or not. But these features cannot be used for animals, because the body design of plants is totally different from animals. The physiology of plant is totally different from that of animals. Plants are autotrophic, that is, they can make their own food, whereas animals, they are heterotrophic, that is, they cannot prepare their own food. Plants are stationary, they remain fixed at one place. They have got mostly supportive tissues, which are mainly made of dead cells. Animals, they are motile, they keep on moving in search of food and all the other requirements. So they have got mostly living tissues. So because of the structural and functional differences that you find in case of plants and animals, the features that are used for classifying plants will be totally different from the features that are used for classifying animals. For classifying animals, we'll be using the features like the development of specialized organ systems like circulatory system, or the presence or absence of backbone, because animals have backbone. So that can be used for classifying animals, but this feature cannot be used for classifying plants. Let us now study about how classification is related to evolution. Classification, as just now I have discussed, is arranging of organisms into groups and subgroups on the basis of the body design in forms and functions. Now, once a body design comes into existence, when it develops, it is going to be passed to the next generations with or without further changes. Generally, a change in the body design keeps on happening. This is because new characters keep on evolving or developing during the course of evolution. And this changes in the body design is very important for complex or new organisms to be formed. Evolution is a process, it's a very slow process, it is a continuous, gradual process wherein complex organisms have formed from simpler organisms through accumulation of changes in the body design. Means once a body design comes into existence, it may be further changed as time passes, as organisms keep on reproducing generation after generation. Changes in the body design keep on happening, and these changes in the body design will keep on accumulating, and during this course of this evolution, new species are formed. Okay, so this change in the body design is very much important, because this helps the organism to, or this allows the organism to survive in a better way. That is, it will be helping the organism to get adapted to the changes that occur in the environment. This is quite important. And this is how this shows that the system of classification that we follow is closely related to evolution, because classification is arranging organisms on the basis of characteristics, and characteristics develop during evolution. As characteristics keep on developing, a change in the body design goes on happening. So there are some characteristics which have evolved quite earlier. They are said to be as basic characteristics, and those are the ones which are used to make the broadest group. When I had discussed earlier, first what happens is when organisms are sorted out, first broader groups are made, and then under each group, subgrouping is done. So those characteristics which have developed earlier, they are the basic characteristics, and they will be used for making the broadest group. And then subgrouping of it will be done on the basis of characteristics which have evolved later. Okay, so that will be, those characteristics will be used for making of subgroups. So this is how the classification and evolution are related. And this idea of evolution was explained by Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin, he gave the theory of natural selection. He had written a book named The Origin of Species in the year 1859, and in that he had given his theory of natural selection, where he stated that as organisms reproduce generation after generations, changes keep on happening in their body design. Like every generation, when they reproduce and they pass a body design, a change in the body design also occurs, and that is also passed, and these changes, this will be repeated many a times, and finally this accumulation of changes in the body design results in formation of a new species. So this was what was explained by Charles Darwin. Now, as I said to you, that once a body design comes into existence, it is going to be passed to the next generation with or without further changes. So at present, if we talk about the present, you find there are organisms which have got a very ancient body design. A body design which have developed long back. Like for example, you take bacteria. Okay, or mycoplasma, it has got a primitive or ancient body design. So such organisms which have got a primitive or ancient body design, they are said to be as primitive organisms. They are also called as lower organisms, or they are called as the older organisms. They have a simple body design, an ancient body design, a body design which has evolved long back. At the same moment, you also have organism like us, we human beings, which we have acquired certain special characteristics, means we have a body design which has recently evolved, and such organisms which have recently evolved body design, they are said to be as advanced organisms, higher organisms, or the younger organism. They are called as younger organisms, right? So this is the difference between the primitive organisms and higher organisms. If you are asked to compare bacteria with amoeba, so what is primitive and what is advanced? Bacteria will be referred as primitive organism, and amoeba, which is eukaryotic, because if we talk in terms of the characteristics, it is first to evolve was a prokaryotic cell design, then to evolve was eukaryotic. So bacteria will be said to be as primitive organism, and amoeba, paramecium, or human being, will be referred to as the younger or the advanced organism. So this is how the system of classification is related to the evolution. And when we study classification, when we sort organisms, that also reveals us, or it tells us that how closely or those different groups of organisms are related to one another in terms of evolution. Here is a difference between the primitive organisms and the advanced organisms. So primitive organisms, as I have said you, are the organisms which have got an ancient body design. That is a body design which has not changed much. Whereas advanced organisms are the organisms which have acquired their body design recently, right? Then the primitive organisms, they are also referred to as lower organisms, or they are also called as older organisms. Whereas the advanced organisms are referred to as higher organisms or the younger organisms. The primitive organisms have a simple body design. So when we talk about the complexity of body design, it is quite simple in case of primitive organisms, whereas advanced organisms, they have got much complex body design. So these are the differences. So if we take example as the bacteria and the other organisms that you see in this picture, bacteria will be referred to as a primitive organism. An organism like amoeba, or you take the examples, all the examples given over here, they will be referred to as advanced organism. So these are the differences between primitive organisms and advanced organisms. Now let us study about the different systems of classification. So one of the earlier system of classification that was accepted for a longer period of time was given by Carolus Linnaeus. He is also called as the father of taxonomy, and he is the one who has his contribution in binomial nomenclature, about which you'll be learning later in this chapter. So Carolus Linnaeus, what he did was he classified the entire living world into two kingdoms, the plantae and kingdom Animalia. Then later on, there was a scientist named Ernest Haeckel. He added a third kingdom, and this is a three kingdom classification. Ernest Haeckel, he divided the living world into three kingdoms. They were Kingdom Protista, Kingdom Plantae, and Kingdom Animalia. So what he did was, all the unicellular organisms which were present in the plant kingdom and animal kingdom, they were separated out and they were placed in a third kingdom, which is called as a Kingdom Protista. Then next was the contribution of Copeland. Copeland added a fourth kingdom in the living world, and what he did was, he added the Kingdom Monera. So all the prokaryotic organisms which were there earlier in Kingdom Protista, they were separated out and they were placed under Kingdom Monera. And thus Copeland gave the four kingdom system of classification, where the living world was classified into four kingdoms, that is Kingdom Monera, including the prokaryotic organisms. The Protista had the eukaryotic unicellular organism, the Kingdom Animalia, and Kingdom Plantae. And the system of classification that we follow now, this is given by Robert Whittaker. So Robert Whittaker divided the entire living world into five kingdoms. And what are those five kingdoms? Let us see. Kingdom Monera, which includes the prokaryotic organisms. Kingdom Protista, which includes eukaryotic unicellular organisms. Then you have got the photosynthetic organisms, which are eukaryotic and multicellular, placed under Kingdom Plantae. And the Kingdom Animalia, including the heterotrophic holozoic organisms, and the fungi, Kingdom Fungi, which included heterotrophic organisms that had cell wall in their cells. So this five kingdom system of classification was given by Robert Whittaker, and this he had classified the living world, he had classified into the five kingdoms on the basis of the characteristics which I have already mentioned. But those characteristics were, one was cell structure, that is organism being eukaryotic or prokaryotic. Then was the body design as unicellular or multicellular. Then it was mode of nutrition, and then the body organization. So on the basis of all these features, Robert Whittaker had classified the living world into these five kingdoms. And there was one more scientist named Carl Woese. What he did was, he divided this Kingdom Monera. So Kingdom Monera was further, which included the prokaryotic organisms, that was further divided by Carl Woese into two domains. So that was Archaebacteria, which include the primitive prokaryotes, and the Eubacteria. The entire living world is divided into five kingdoms, and then each of these kingdoms are further subdivided. So there are many categories, subdivisions under each of the groups. So here, these different categories, which are of different levels, these categories are called as taxonomic categories. The highest category is kingdom. Now, every kingdom has got many phyla. So all the organisms of a particular kingdom, which have got huge number of features in common, they'll be placed in one phylum. So every kingdom will have many such phyla. Then each phylum will have many classes. Every class has many orders. Under each order, there are many families present. Then every family will have many genus. And under each genus, there'll be many species present. So these are the different taxonomic categories, and species is the smallest unit of classification. It is the basic unit of classification, which includes organisms which are similar enough to breed and produce fertile offspring. So here you have got a picture showing the definition. This shows the meaning of a species. Here what you find is that if toads of different varieties, a male and a female of any of the variety of toad, is made to breed, a fertile offspring, a young one is produced. Similarly, if different varieties or breeds of frogs, and in them the male and the female frog breeds, you will find a young one or offspring produced. But if suppose a toad is made to reproduce or breed with a frog, then either young one will not be made, and even if the young one is made, it will be a sterile. It will not be viable to produce young ones or offspring. So this shows that toad and frogs are of different species. So in this way, there are many species present. On Earth, you find millions and millions of species present, many of which have been discovered, but a good number of species have till now not been discovered.